So we have threats at the user level, we have threats at the kernel level. We will now see what are some of the interactions that are necessary in order to efficiently manage threats. Consider we have a multi-threaded process, and let's say that process has 4 user-level threats. However, the process is such that at any given point of time, the actual level of concurrency is just 2. Basically, if you look at the process, it always happens that 2 of its user-level threads are waiting on IO, and then some other 2 are actually executing. So if our operating system has a limit on the number of kernel threads that it can support, it would be nice if the user-level process actually said, I just really need 2 threads. So when the process starts, the kernel will first give it, let's say, a default number of kernel-level threads and the accompanying lightweight threads, and let's say that is 1. Then the process will request additional kernel-level threads, and the way it's done is that the kernel now supports a system call called setConcurrency. In response to this system call, the kernel will create additional threads, and it will allocate those to this process. Now, let's consider the scenario in which the 2 user-level threads that were mapped on the underlying kernel-level threads block. They needed to perform some IO operation, and then they were basically moved on the wait queue that's associated with that particular IO event. So the kernel-level threads are blocked as well. Now, let's say we have a situation in which the 2 user-level threads that were running concurrent level threads issued an IO request and now have to wait for that to complete, so it's a blocking IO. What that means is that the kernel level threads themselves, they're also blocked on that IO operation. They're waiting in a queue somewhere in the kernel for that IO event to occur. Now we have a situation where the process as a whole is blocked because it only had 2 kernel level threads, both of them are blocked, and there are user level threads that are ready to run and make progress. The reason why this is happening is because the user-level library doesn't know what is happening in the kernel. It doesn't know that the kernel threads are about to block. What would have really been useful is if the kernel had notified the user-level library before it blocks the kernel-level threads, and then the user-level library can look at its run queue. It can see that it has multiple runnable user-level threads, and in response can let the kernel know, so call a system call, to request more kernel-level threads or lightweight processes. Now, in response to this call, the kernel can allocate an extra kernel-level thread, and the library can start scheduling the remaining user-level threads onto the associated lightweight process. At a later time, when the IO operation completes, at some point, the kernel will notice that one of the kernel-level threads is pretty much constantly idle, because we said that that's the natural state of this particular application. So maybe the kernel can tell the kernel level library that you no longer have access to this kernel level threads, you can schedule on it. By going through these examples, we realize that both the user level library doesn't know what's happening in the kernel, but also the kernel doesn't know what's happening at the user level. Both of these facts cause for some problems. To correct for these issues, we saw how in the Solaris threading implementation, they introduced certain system calls and special signals that can be used to pass or request certain things among these 2 layers. And basically, this is how the kernel level and the user level thread management interact and coordinate.